Hi. Good morning, everyone. My name is Leo Gertner, and I am the symposium editor for the Review of Law and Social Change, which will not surprise you is a non-union and unremunerated job. But hopefully we can change that by the end of the day. So I came by this position because someone came up to me and asked, do you want to be symposium editor? Nobody else wants to do it. And I said, can it be about labor? And so here we are today, with a wonderful lineup of panelists and an even more wonderful audience. And as the kids say these days, sorry, not sorry. Okay. So in all seriousness, an important question was raised during the Q&A session last night after our screening of The Hand That Feeds, the documentary about a handful of deli workers associated with the Laundry Workers Center who are trying to form a small independent union. And you know, to paraphrase the question, why didn't established national unions want to represent them? I won't get into the answer to that, but maybe Mr. Mahoma López and Marilio Ortega, who are on the first panel, can start to answer that. But I think it touches on a lot of the tensions and the strategies and opportunities that the new labor landscape offers, which we're here to talk about. In the last few years, we've seen tremendous innovation in labor organizing through worker centers, campaigns like the Fight for 15, higher education, digital media organizing campaigns, and so forth. But the innovation isn't just in labor organizing, it's also in organizing in general. We've got the debt resistance movements, Black Lives Matter groups across the country, amazing environmental and housing organizing, the immigration movement and the Dreamers, the LGBT movement, and so many other organizing efforts. So how is our legal framework keeping up with this groundswell of organizing? How is the NLRB going to adapt? Can it adapt fast enough for the burgeoning gig economy? Will its new election rules and decisions on franchisees help workers on the ground? Should workers really try for a contract and a union? A lot of people here and everywhere around the country are asking these questions, and as a panelist last night said, if we come up with some answers today, please let him know. What I think we know now from all the workers involved in worker centers, and also from people working within the unions who have an increasing awareness of the issues at stake, is that there's no one-size-fits-all model to achieving better working conditions. But there are best practices and different paths that we have to consider seriously. So I hope you're as excited as I am for today to talk about those things. So let me say a few thank yous and then you're gonna be rid of me. I wanna thank our partners for making this possible, especially the Latin American Law Students Association, who donated generously, and their two co-chairs who happen to be part of our journal, and one of whom, Elisa Carino, will be editor-in-chief next year. And she's abroad right now, but we're really happy to have her. I also want to thank the Peggy Browning Fund, which has not only supported me personally as a past fellow, but can claim to support several organizations represented at the panels today. And they fully fund summer fellows who are hopefully going to be future labor lawyers. So we're really happy to have their support today. Thank you to the Cornell Worker Institute and Professor Kate Griffith as well for their support. We're lucky to count on one of the country's premier labor education institutions. And we also wouldn't be here today without the Symposium Planning Committee of the Journal and its hardworking members, and our moderators today who've been tremendously thoughtful in planning all the panels, which I take no credit for. And a special thanks goes to our Symposium Advisor, Professor Cynthia Esland, who will be with us later today and has inspired lots of labor students throughout the years. And of course, a thank you to all the workers at NYU who make every day possible at this institution. Maybe we'll hear from some of you later today. I'm sure we will. There's a lot going on at NYU. And I just wanted to bring up as one final comment that it's also important to remember that 105 years ago to the day, 123 young women and 23 young men died very close to here in the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory fire. And as we now know, the doors were locked and nobody could escape and there were no fire alarms. So, and we're also almost 3 years out from the Rana Plaza atrocity in Bangladesh. But what's often forgotten about the Triangle Shirtwaist factory fire is that 2 years earlier, 20,000 workers went out on strike led by Clara Lemlich, a 23-year-old Ukrainian worker. In 1909, after a long meeting, she famously said, "I have listened to all the speakers and I have no further patience for talk. I am a working girl, one of those striking against intolerable conditions. I am tired of listening to speakers who talk in generalities. What we are here for is to decide whether or not to strike. I make a motion that we go out on in a general strike." And so they did. I think we owe a tremendous debt to them and their comrades and for their struggles, which contributed in no small part to the labor laws we have today, including the NLRA. I think we honor their memory, as that panelist said last night, by trying to find some answers. With that, please remember, if you sign up for CLE credit, to sign in with your time and signature. You'll get your CLE credit by email, so please don't misspell your email address or I will have to come after you. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to come up and ask me anytime. With that, I hand you over to our wonderful editors-in-chief, Claire Glenn and Sarah Braffman. Thank you.
Hi, and welcome to the Review of Law and Social Changes Symposium. Dishwashers, day laborers, and domestic workers can alternative labor revive the labor movement. The symposium is a vital part of the Review of Law and Social Changes mission, and that mission is to amplify the voices that are often discounted in formal legal spaces to help bring hallmarks of prestige to radical, progressive social change ideals and goals. And we are dedicated to publishing only literature with a page-to-practice model that has relevance for practitioners on the ground. And today's symposium highlights especially how worker justice is social justice. Labor and work permeate every facet of our lives and livelihood. And we're here to highlight the growth and expansion of the movement itself, so the Fight for 15 and other burgeoning movements that we heard from about last night as well. And we are hearing this more and more in the conversation and political candidates talking about these issues as well. And we especially chose this topic not only because Leo is very close to labor, but also because labor is a very important part of broader social justice movements and intersects as well with immigrant rights, women's rights, racial justice, and that those are the kinds of issues that we highlight both in the journal and that we wanted to highlight as part of our symposium. So thank you so much for being here, and I'm gonna turn it over to my co-editor, Claire Glenn.
So we wanna reiterate Leo's thank yous to our speakers, moderators, panelists today, to our supporters and contributors, and especially to the workers at NYU who make everything that we do possible. I also want to take this opportunity to thank Leo Gertner. His tireless and passionate work has really made all of this possible. He's put together a really fabulous day today, and he's, I think, really made sure that this would be a really valuable contribution to labor activism. I want to encourage all of you as attendees to pick up copies of our most recent issues, which are just out at the registration table as you came in. We are very, very proud of our authors, many of whom are practitioners who are working every day in the field tirelessly to make this work happen. As Sarah mentioned, our mission as a journal is to advance progressive and concrete legal change. And through publishing this scholarship and hosting events like this, that really helps us fulfill that mission. So finally, I want to thank everyone who's in attendance today. I want to thank you for your engagement and your participation. We'll be talking today about the challenges and issues that we face, but also looking to the future of this movement and our role as lawyers and advocates in advancing social justice. So thank you all.
Okay, welcome. So when we were invited to this panel, there were a couple questions that were asked of us. Why do alternative labor organizations exist? What are they? How do their methods and goals differ from labor unions? And what are alternative labor organizations' shortcomings? Can the alternative labor model work for less traditional workers in the service sector? So we've got some great people on the panel today who are going to tell us their experiences working and touch on some of these questions. We do have to actually change the order a little bit. Julie is gonna go first because she has a previous engagement. But I'd just like to introduce each one of the panelists by their name and title, and they're each going to go into their stories in depth. But before I do, I'll just say that my name is Shawn Sebastian. I work at the Center for Popular Democracy, and I'm the field director for the Federal Reserve campaign called Fed Up, which works to bring more pro-worker monetary policy to America. And the Center for Popular Democracy is a network of grassroots organizations, 43 grassroots organizations across the country that work on campaigns on economic justice, racial justice, and immigrant justice. And if you are interested in interning, either term time or summer, you should come talk to me. Shameless plug. So Julie Mao is the Enforcement Fellow at the National Immigration Project of the National Lawyers Guild. Elizabeth Joynes Jordan is the Supervising Attorney at Make the Road New York. Juan Goris is the organizer at Make the Road New York. And Mahoma López Garfias is the Co-Director of the Laundry Workers Center. And Morelia Ortega is a worker leader at the Laundry Workers Center. So with that, we'll start with Julie.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us on a morning of Good Friday. It shows the amount of dedication you guys have to these issues. I will also just say, I am a lawyer at the National Immigration Project. I was formerly, just a couple months ago, at an organization called the New Orleans Worker Center for Racial Justice that supports a lot of black and brown worker organizing across the South and in New Orleans. I also just want to recognize that I'm very humbled to be on this panel, and I certainly apologize for going first because I always believe that workers' voices deserve to go first. And I also see so many familiar faces in the audience. And I really encourage that this be used as a space to not just listen to people on the panel, but also connect and dialogue with yourselves, because what we're trying to build here is not just a space for intellectual distribution of information, but to build a movement space for each other, to support each other. So I will say that this was a really hard topic. There are fundamental questions that I think advocates and workers themselves are struggling to answer, and is certainly apropos for this political and social moment in time. So I jotted some points down on my ride over, just to kind of frame out what I'm thinking and kind of frame out this discussion. It tries to be logical. So I think that if the question is, how do we revive the labor movement, or how do we build the labor movement itself? I think then my answer would be, if we want to build or revive labor as an institution or the labor movement, we have to be able to support, show up, and invest in building a movement first, right? We can't talk about an issue or a particular institution until we think about how do we invest in a larger movement that is happening in America today? And I think that if we're talking about, you know, why do we organize or who do we organize to revive the labor movement, I think that everyone that was there yesterday for the discussion and for the movie can, I think we can all agree that if we want to build a strong labor movement, we have to be able to organize Black workers. We have to be able to organize marginalized workers, workers with criminal convictions, low-wage workers, undocumented workers, Latino and Asian workers, because this is the segment of our population that is the oftentimes the most disadvantaged, the most in crisis because of political and economic situations. The difficulty, I think, for the labor movement at this particular moment is that these particular communities are being attacked not just economically, but in so many other ways, right? So we're thinking through these movements that are growing, like the Black Lives Matter movement, like Not One More, when they're dealing with state violence, not just economic violence by employers. Then it has to be that labor has to show up for those other movements in order to be able to even begin to talk and organize marginalized workers, right? If someone who is undocumented, who happens to be a worker at a shop that you're organizing, if someone is Black and comes to, you know, an organizer, and they're talking about police violence, and they're talking about their daughter or sister who's been taken away by ICE, the response to that is not, I can't do anything about that, but would you like to organize with about, you know, a campaign with your boss? The right response is, well, how do I, as labor, show up for you in this moment of crisis, and how do we build collectively a movement to attack all those points of state violence and economic violence, right? And I will say that I certainly learned that the hard way from my experience, and I will just give you one example from the work that I did in New Orleans. So in New Orleans, the main project that I worked with is called the Congress of Day Laborers, which is also Congreso de Jornaleros. And it comes out of really radical work, a model of worker centers from the 80s and 90s, you know, that did labor hiring halls. So there was a lot of anti-immigrant, you know, harboring laws that related to employment coming out of California in the 80s and the 90s. And so what the movement kind of did and to kind of facilitate and fight back was to begin to organize day laborers around the injustices of their transactions with employers, and to be able to help them bargain with employers using particular space, right? The labor hiring hall, where organizers would help workers bargain for their wages, they would set working conditions, they would set wage levels. That worked really well for a period of time. Unfortunately, though, I think what I learned very quickly in New Orleans is that those traditional labor halls didn't really make sense in the political economy of New Orleans. There were, you know, post-Katrina, hundreds and hundreds of day laborers, immigrant workers, undocumented workers who came down to rebuild the city, right? But they were deeply frightened by local law enforcement, by ICE, who were essentially going to these day labor spaces and rounding people up. And because of programs like Secure Communities, which places ICE agents in the jails and allows for transfers to ICE, many individuals were essentially going to day labor spaces, getting arrested by local police due to harassment, and being deported. And so there was a tremendous amount of push, you know, not just to do sort of the wage theft traditional day labor work, but to also defend them and defend their ability to stand in public spaces as Latino individuals, as undocumented people. And that, you know, it really shifted the organizing from traditional, or I mean, it's still really non-traditional labor organizing, but even more to social movement organizing. And what we began to realize was that, you know, we were building this huge, huge base because we had shifted to really recognize these workers, not just for the issue of their labor, but to recognize that organizing involves recognizing their full humanity, and that that full humanity required us to fight their deportations and to make sure that they can stand in public spaces. And so now Congreso de Jornaleros is a predominantly law enforcement, civil rights oriented institution. It has a membership of 2,000, and you know, they, if you look online at their Facebook page, you know, they have weekly meetings of 200, 300 people, right? I mean, who can say, even for labor, you can fill up their meeting halls with that many people weekly, right? And the reality is that it is building up a culture of organizing within the Latino and undocumented community that is having interesting and very positive effects on general labor in that region. So for example, many of the workers, because we've been able to stop their deportations, now have work permits. And they're entering into the painters and the carpenters and the trade unions and really impacting the culture of those unions, right? They've had to hire an organizer that speaks Spanish, who's Latino, and, you know, shows up. That organizer often is called by, you know, our membership and their cross membership to show up at protests at ICE and to speak out. And so it benefits everyone, and really, in order to build this movement, we have to be able to show up for other movements, because when we do that, everybody's issues get lifted. And I think that that's, you know, in the current work that I do at the National Immigration Project, it's a lot of working with community groups around ICE and police issues. And we've been working very closely with the National Educators Association and the AFT around the raids of students in North Carolina and Atlanta. And it's been, I think, reviving, frankly, their membership in North Carolina to see teachers go out by the hundreds and support their students, and see students also support and stand out on deportation issues. And that is going to benefit everyone in building this infrastructure that pushes back against not just labor issues, but, you know, many anti-immigrant, anti-black, anti-civil rights issues. And I think that's the type of movement that we need to build and that we all need to support in order for us to revive a particular section of our movement. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Julie. So we do have a limited amount of time for everyone else, so I think we'll hold questions to the end, and we'll move on to Elizabeth.
Okay. Good morning. We are also don't come with answers to all of Sean's hard questions, but we want to share a little bit with you about our movement building work at Make the Road New York. And specifically, Juan and I have been working together on the car wash campaign, and hopefully some of the reflections of our experience will just raise discussion about some of those questions. So for those of you who are not familiar with Make the Road New York, we're a membership-based organization. We now have over 19,000 members across New York, and we are fighting for and building the power of immigrant and working class communities. We have offices in Bushwick, Brooklyn, Jackson Heights, Queens, Staten Island, and Long Island. Our work is based around membership committees that are focused on different issue areas. We have many different issue areas, from education, LGBTQ rights, immigration and civil rights, housing and benefits, and our work is focused on workplace justice. In support of our organizing campaigns, which are really identified and driven by our membership, we also have a legal services and other survival services program. Our legal services provide both direct representation to our members, in our case, members who have employment issues. The bulk of our work is on wage theft across New York, which, as you all know, remains rampant. But we also have an immigration legal team. Going back to a little bit about what Julie was saying, you know, we really do also recognize the need to provide a range of services so that workers can show up and organize and fight for the campaigns that that are meaningful to them. In addition to the direct services, we also provide legal support to our organizing campaigns. That includes some legislative reform and policy work, research, and support to our campaign members. We are working to raise the standards across New York. We are going to hear more from Juan about our car wash campaign, which is an industry-specific campaign and has been going on for the last 4 to 5 years. But this all comes from collaborative efforts with labor. So it's a little bit of a kind of unique model. Our main workplace justice campaigns now are against wage theft, the Fight for 15. We saw yesterday that NYU's student workers won the right to a minimum wage of 15, so that's exciting. We are also involved in the Fed Up campaign that Shawn mentioned and eliminating the tip wage. So we'll hear a little from Juan and talk a little bit more about how the legal work has supported the organizing campaign.
So I just kind of want to start off talking about a little bit of history of the car wash for folks that are not familiar with the car wash campaign. Started about 4 or 5 years ago. There's approximately 200 car washes that operate in New York City, employing about 5,000 workers or more. And something that really, when workers started reaching out to different organizations, something that stood out was the rampant wage theft that was happening throughout the industry, where workers were making $4 to $5 working 80 hours, sometimes being paid only for 50 hours, and there was no way for them to stand up to the boss and tell them, hey, you need to pay all my hours. There was no overtime, so they were working all these hours. There was no overtime, no less, no spread hours, none of that sort. Also, it was the exposure of the safety, the unsafe conditions that at work, where workers had accidents from, you know, being crushed by cars, death. We have workers whose legs have been caught in the bell of the tunnel. And there's no way for these workers to, you know, stand up to the owners. Like, you need to, you know, this just can't happen. This needs to be, like, ways to prevent this. And this is what really caught the attention of the campaign when folks, car wash workers, like, hey, this is happening, not just at one car wash, but at many different car washes. Something also that folks that are not familiar, these are not just, like, your mom and pop's car washes. These are owners who own multiple shops and sometimes even chains. But some shops are 10, 25 folks, but then you have car washes that have 70 car washes, 70 car wash workers there. Also something that also stood out was the environmental safety aspect of it, where you have these huge car washes that are using very dangerous chemicals. Workers are being exposed. Workers have been exposed to skin conditions, fungus in the fingers, and they provide no safety training for the workers. Also, the way that these owners dispose of their chemicals is sometimes very, they will throw it down the street, dispose in regular trash cans. This has been reported where owners have deposited of these chemicals down the rivers in different parts of New York City. And it's something that, you know, if you're not like under your ass, you're talking to workers, you won't know, because these guys just operate without no license. They can just, anyone can just go open a car wash at this moment, and no one, there's no oversight of what's actually happening at these car washes at this moment. So the solution that we kind of sought to it was, with after talking to workers and different organizations to come together, was that these workers need to organize. So with the help of NYCC, Make the Road, and the support of RWDSU, the Retail Wholesale Department Store Union, they decided to put this campaign together and started reaching out to workers. But now also, they also reached out to community-based organizations, the faith community, and immigration community to support these workers. And it's something that has really supported and raised the standards in different car washes where workers are making $4 an hour. Now you have workers that the minimum are making minimum wage, which was unheard of before in the car wash industry.
Yeah. So a little bit more about the legal support and how we've worked together with the organizers. We started out by mapping the industry and really have a sense of all the players in New York City. Obviously, this is a contained universe, so it's, you know, was a good option for an industry to kind of start with. It also had some of the most rampant abuse that we've seen in low-wage industries. We targeted some of the worst actors through litigation and brought wage and hour lawsuits against them, and we've won back hundreds of thousands of dollars for workers. We also referred some of those cases to government agencies, including the Attorney General's Office, Labor Bureau, and the New York State DOL. We worked to kind of strategically file a group of cases. So we went, after we had started seeing some improvements in the industry, we kind of targeted people who were still bottom feeders in Brooklyn, identified a dozen car washes, who I think were still providing car washes for under $10, which we knew meant that they really couldn't be paying their workers at the legal rates, and filed those with the New York State DOL at the same time. They went in and did kind of unannounced on-site investigations as part of a larger sweep. And in addition to the individual cases, we are also, as I mentioned earlier, providing these kind of wraparound services to our members. So a lot of the car wash workers have come with immigration issues, health issues, you know, looking for help just with, you know, tax help. And so we're really trying to kind of address all of their legal needs and, you know, as they are organizing the other workers. It's been interesting to see a lot of the workers from some of our first cases a few years ago have really stepped up to help out in newer cases, talking to workers who are considering bringing lawsuits or in the middle of, you know, experiencing retaliation from their bosses after they do file lawsuits. We've had, you know, a lot of different stories. I'm not going to go into all the cases, but we've seen that the bosses are really not scared to retaliate. They are threatening workers, making deals, you know, or trying to make deals with workers, giving them really low offers to just make this go away. We wanted to just highlight one case, which is at Vegas Car Wash, and then I think we'll move on and leave time for everyone else.
So this case was particularly interesting. It's a small car wash out in Park Slope, where workers had reached out to the campaign to some of the organizers, and we're just like, you know, this guy is paying us $4 for not paying any. Overtime, workers had reported being executed by like vacuums, the machines were not working properly, and workers had been injured. And so at first it was just a wage theft campaign where the organizer was working with the workers to, you know, get their money back from all the years. Some workers had reported for the last 10 years not receiving any overtime at all. So from there, once the owner got heard of the lawsuit from the workers and that they had organized and they were going to stand by the lawsuit, the owner just locked them out and the workers had decided that they were gonna go on strike. So it was about a year and a half ago, like the coldest winter in New York City, and we stand there. We stood with the workers 7 days a week from 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. In front of the car wash. And you know, it wasn't the tip of these guys had no money in the pockets. The little stipend that the union was able to provide wasn't enough for them to survive. So we had to find strategies to like keep these guys on the line. So that meant like reaching out to the community, doing fundraisers, and luckily also reaching out to politicians. And that was great because they were able to garner a lot of support through the community, and the Parksville community did a great job coming around for these guys and supporting them, not washing the cars there, and also the faith community turned out there. We had many actions there. There was a huge protest where it was civil disobedience, where you know, the president of different of the organizations, like Make the Road, NYCC, and also the union, blocked the streets, and there was a ton of support, and that's what really brought a lot of tension from the community, but also put a lot of pressure on the owner to settle the case for these guys. So after that part, there was a part where they had to settle the wage theft, but also the workers had decided at that point, after being 5-6 months out on strike, that they wanted a union to prevent it from happening again. So they were able to settle, but also winning the contract and to prevent it from happening again. So, you know, I think it's a perfect from everything that Elizabeth mentioned about the support that Make the Road provides and bringing that into the campaign, which is like really provides like an all-around support for these workers that traditionally in the labor movement hasn't been brought.
So the final piece of the campaign is just, you know, recognizing that, you know, we can't really build change in the industry just going one car wash to the next car wash. You know, we have spent years, but really what we have learned is the need for accountability and regulation. So out of our experience, we worked with the workers to draft the Car Wash Accountability Act, which passed last year. It's a city law. It requires a licensing, it requires car washes to be licensed in New York City, disclose basic corporate information that make them accountable, and you know, so workers can figure out who their bosses are. Annually certify that the business is in compliance with basic worker protection and environmental laws, and requires an $150,000 bond. That law passed. The DCA will be enforcing that law. They are set to issue rules any day now. The law is being challenged in court by the Car Wash Association, and some of the worst actors that we know about are plaintiffs in that lawsuit. So stay tuned, but we're still fighting.
Thank you. And lastly, we'll hear from the Laundry Workers Center, Mahoma López Garfias, the co-director, and Morelia Ortega, a worker leader.
Hello, everybody. Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, we're very happy to be here today. Thank you so much for the invitation, and thank you to be patient, just basically hearing what we had to say. So just basically to support what the compañero Juan Gorriz says, is basically what exactly face every day in Laundry Worker Center. So basically, what can I say about Laundry Worker Center is when we found the organization, just basically the main goal is bring the most leaders in our community. So we believe just basically to build the labor movement, we need all those leaders in our communities. So in the case, I have the great opportunity to be the main leader in the Hat and Crossy campaign. But we have all the energy and we have the commitment to do something, but also to be able to do that or have a successful victory, we need to have a structure. So basically what always we provide in Laundry Worker Center is a lot of trainings to the new members, just basically to transform that leaders into organizers. But additional to that, what is my experience in Laundry Worker Center, and also what always we push is like, in the case, in the legal case, always we push the envelope used to the workers have to be in the table of the negotiations. So because we believe in the table of the negotiations, we balance the equal power between the worker and the owner or the bosses. Because always we believe if you are a worker, you are oppressed for many years, you always think you cannot be on the equal as the owner or the boss. So basically part of the training, and we had the great fortune to working with Jeannie Miter, which all as an attorney, which is sitting in the back, always they give you that opportunity, just basically to bring the workers on the table of the negotiations and let the workers just basically run the negotiations. So many of the things we are facing also in the organizing process is like we don't have economic resources like the big unions or probably other groups, but that's no impediment to organize. So having Krusty, we won that campaign in the McDonald's. All the meetings we have in the McDonald's or in the parks. So the last successful campaign just win a few months ago, which is BNH workers. We don't have basically space for 300, sometimes 200 workers. We need to find a special public places, just basically which we congregate all the workers to organize. But part of that is like in every single process, just basically to be successful, we need to involve the workers. We need to build the leadership, and we need to provide a lot of training just basically to the campaign be strong. So basically, a lot of people ask to us, so how you do it? How you can win one campaign and another campaign? It just basically, we pull all the resources we had, which is no economic resources, but it's trainings. We provide those trainings to the workers. So even the majority of the workers, we don't have documents. And it's difficult just to give that a step because everybody feels that's a natural fear, just basically to be deported, or sometimes during the picket lines, the police department is more aggressively, sometimes not even the owner, but the police just came to defend the private property. They're really aggressive to the people in the picket lines. So basically how you confront all that fears is basically having a lot of training, provide a lot of political consciousness about what's the movement, and teach them about what's the history the labor history in this country. So we have different challenges. Each campaign is totally different. But one of the things, we don't believe too much in the institutions. Like always, we believe that the institutions are weak because they work more for the system. So we have, just to share this experience, we have a campaign in Washington Heights, which is only one worker, a woman, which that person, the owner, hit in the face with a metal tray. So she approached to us because he saw the flyer of the organization. She approached the organization thinking we found jobs in the laundromats. We say no, our organization just basically, we provide training, we help to the workers to know about their rights. So she started telling us her history, and was very sad because she suffered for many years exploitation, abuse, discrimination. So even if it's one person, we say, well, you know, we believe you have a lot of, you are a very strong woman, and you can be a leader in your community. So the Laundry Worker Center, we take the commitment just basically to training her. And when she take 8 weeks at the Leadership Institute training, and then when she was ready, she launched public their own campaign. against the owner, which basically exploited for many years. Was we confront a lot of challenges because the owner of that bakery was very good friend of Danis Rodriguez. So every time we have a picket line, we had 5 police cars, 2 undercover cars police. In one occasion, we had the attorney of the police, I mean the prison. And we need to be more creative because in that point, we need to go to the CB12, just basically to put pressure to the CB12 about what the police department is doing. In other, and that's basically we teach to that worker how basically she had to conduct all these meetings. And when finally the owner pay all the money or the majority of the money, the owner hold illegally. But in some point she was one of the main leaders. She have the main person which conduct a rally for the women's rights here in the city was very excited because we transformed the life of that person. So in the case of the Liberato, which the owner of the restaurant just basically sue the workers and the organization with the RICO case, you can imagine workers, they don't even make a minimum wage, mm-hmm. but the owner sue the workers with a RICO case for extortion. How a worker which basically is demanding, pay me at least what I deserve by law, you sue me by this kind of law. But basically that's part of the system because the judge accept this case. Even if they don't have basis, we are having this contradiction about, well, the system is support us or is against us because we don't that case don't have any basis. They open that case and the judge is basically supporting, they are in favor of the owner. So that's like when we're talking about economic resources, they only do that because they can kill us very easily with one case like that because it's super expensive. So that's why when we say we have things to Jeannie because always we put her in a lot of troubles and always she defend us as a pro bono. So that's why like we never, even when the owners or the bosses use very dirty tactics, we never step back. We say, okay, we don't care the consequence. They don't have nothing to take us. You know, they say, okay, you have to pay. Well, I don't know what you're gonna take, probably my TV or my printer, but that's the only thing value I have in my house. So basically, we don't have nothing to lose. So that's why we take those risks. That's the only way to win. But the most important thing just basically is, yeah. Mm-hmm. But also, the main commitment of the organization is, like I said before, is the labor movement needs to grow up. We found New York Workers Federation used in 2014. The main goal is to the all the worker centers be more stronger. Like we believe is no as a worker center be independent is okay, but also we need to bring all the different industries together because that's the only way. So how long the worker center we want all these campaigns is basically for the solidarity with the community, different groups and also the unions. And I think that's the only way to grow up the labor movement. And that's why basically we do, and hopefully we continue bring more leaders to the community.
Buenos días a todos. Gracias por la invitación.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for the invitation.
El compañero Mahoma acaba de resumir prácticamente todo lo que trabajamos en la organización.
My coworker Mahoma just summarized practically everything that we do in the organization.
Realmente no trabajamos de una manera distinta a las otras organizaciones. Todos perseguimos, creo, el mismo fin.
really, we don't work in any different way than the other organizations. I think that we all are seeking the same goal.
Que es organizar a la gente, es organizar a las personas que están siendo asediadas, están siendo abusadas, están siendo maltratadas en su centro de trabajo.
Which is to organize people. It's to organize people that are being exploited, that are being abused, that are being disadvantaged in their workplace.
Como también lo acabo de resumir en el tiempo que llevamos trabajando en esta línea.
As he recently summarized, in all the time that we've been working on these issues.
No ha sido fácil para nosotros.
It hasn't been easy for us.
Hemos tenido acosos, hemos tenido demandas, hemos tenido de todo tipo de presión.
We've had harassment against us, we've had lawsuits, we've had all kinds of pressure against us.
Pero abrazamos esta, ¿cómo se llama? ¿Cómo le diré? Abrazamos esta actividad más por amor propio.
But we embrace this activity because we love it.
La organización no tiene los recursos suficientes como para llevar a cabo campañas grandes.
The organization does not have sufficient resources to carry out large campaigns.
Pero igual con nuestros propios recursos y conforme a nuestras posibilidades, nosotros estamos tratando de educar y organizar a la gente para que denuncien sus abusos.
But at any rate, with the resources that we do have, we are trying to organize people so that they can denounce and report the abuses they suffer.
Nosotros estamos conscientes y tenemos la convicción de que solo de esa forma vamos a hacer un cambio en el movimiento laboral. Nosotros estamos abrazamos esta consigna, esta actividad, porque estamos conscientes o tenemos la convicción de que solo trabajando de esa forma vamos a hacer un cambio en el movimiento laboral.
We are conscious and we have the conviction that only working in this way will we be able to make a change in the labor and workers movement.
De hecho, hemos trabajado bastantes campañas. Afortunadamente, a la fecha, todos hemos salido victoriosos.
We have worked on many campaigns, and fortunately, to this date, we have been victorious in all of them.
Y aunque la organización tenga nombre de lavandería, realmente estamos abiertos a todo tipo de trabajadores que se acercan a nosotros.
Although the organization is called the Laundry Worker Center, in reality, we are open to all kinds of workers that approach us for help.
Entonces, pues nada más nos queda seguir trabajando. No hemos caminado solos, como lo dijo Mahoma.
What we have to do is continue working. As Mahoma said, we have not been in this struggle alone.
Tenemos el apoyo de la comunidad. Tenemos el apoyo de organizaciones similares a las nuestras. Inclusive hemos hemos tomado partido con sindicatos que nos han apoyado en esas campañas.
We have the support of the community. We have support of groups that are similar to our own, and including unions that have taken sides and have participated in our campaigns.
Nuestra campaña insignia fue precisamente la de Hatton Crosti, que tenemos por ahí un ¿cómo se llama? Un documental que a lo mejor la mayoría de ustedes lo ha visto. Nos sentimos orgullosos por eso, pero igual tenemos que seguir trabajando.
We're very proud, especially of our Hot and Crusty campaign. As you know, that there's a documentary that's been made of it. Maybe most people in this room have seen it. But nonetheless, we have to keep working.
Gracias.
Thank you very much.
I want to say the last thing very quickly. So just basically sometimes when the first time I met with a worker, sometimes I feel like I'm a little strong or tough because the workers complain like, okay, I have rights and nobody respects my rights. And I say, well, of course you have a rights, but you know the history of the labor movement? A lot of people die for the rights you have now. So basically your commitment is continue fighting for those rights. And it's like right away you have a connection right there. It's like, because a lot of generations in the past die to have at least half of the right we have right now. So that's also I want to share that to you. Is never forget the labor history, you know?
Yeah, thank you. So I'd like to open it up to questions from the audience, and I'll start out because I have a couple questions for the panelists. One thing I'm curious about with the Make the Road campaign, you talked about a lot of different types of services, wraparound services that you provide. You provide direct services, you wrote legislation and passed legislation, you did like a full campaign. So there's a lot of law students in the audience. So I'm wondering, you know, you guys made a big change in the car wash industry. What aren't the students in law school learning in order to make change? Like what are the tactics and things like that that you needed beyond what you learned in law classes to pass this accountability and regulation law?
I'm gonna let Juan take that because I think the truth is, you know, we, the legal team has been supporting individual cases and kind of taking the lead on those, but really in support of the workers. I think the organizing piece is really the critical piece and the reason that we have been able to have any of these victories, even in the individual lawsuits. I mean, keeping folks around for lawsuits that sometimes can take 3 to 4 years. We have not been sued yet ourselves, but you know, the defendants come with a lot of money and a lot of power and dirty tactics, one after the other. So I think you can maybe talk a little bit about the organizing that is behind all of it.
I mean, I don't think there's a particular law that's gonna solve anything or like any specific tactic that's gonna bring along. Mm-hmm. It'll be more of a, like a movement that we need to change the laws that we're currently, because they currently suck and are against the workers. So, so I think it's more of a movement. But we still do need like creative people to come along to see how can this be achieved. I think that's mostly, I'm not sure or have the idea of what needs to be taught in the room to bring it, but I think it's more important is the movement and grown leaders to change the current laws that we currently have.
And I think just one thing to add for the law students is, you know, in New York we're lucky, and I think lots of people in this room have worked to strengthen the laws here, and we have some of the best laws for workers compared to other places around the country, but without enforcement, those laws really don't mean much to the workers on the ground, and the enforcement pieces, you know, take years. It has to be a sustained movement that really the workers themselves are learning how to enforce because there's just not enough advocates, and it's really can't be effective without that.
Yeah, right here.
I have a question for Elizabeth about the Car Wash Accountability Act. You mentioned, I believe, that there's a labor and safe working conditions certification process, and I was just wondering if you could elaborate a little bit more about how that process will work. Is there an opportunity for workers to provide, you know, verification? Who will enforce it? Just, yeah, if you could tell us a little bit more.
Yeah, I can't give you too many more details because, as we mentioned, the Department of Consumer Affairs is currently drafting and has not yet issued the rules that will be implementing the regulation. So, but I'm happy to talk to you a little bit after about some of the ideas. So we're waiting for those rules and we'll see how they work on the ground.
Mahoma, I had another question for you. I thought it was interesting. you said you don't believe in institutions. Is that right?
Yes, it's in the, like example, in the case of the Liberato restaurant, just basically when you are in a federal court, just basically you are demanding justice for workers who basically don't receive minimum wage. They are victims of sexual harassment, verbal abuse, physical abuse. Just basically you have this judge which basically has to be in support of the workers or the victims. They basically, that judge was in very well supporting the other side, which basically in the side of the owner. So right. How you believe on this institution, which basically you open a case, that's the lawyer or the attorney of Liberato. Mm-hmm. He was part of the, he was member of the community board number 12. Mm-hmm. So how you acting as a member of the community in the Bronx, in the Manhattan, and you came to the Bronx just basically to attack a different group of workers.
Right.
Which basically is the whole,
yeah.
Not everything, but at least, you know, when you see all these holes in the system, just basically you cannot trust. That's why PAR always tried to settle all the campaigns out of the court. When we put all kind of pressure and we take different kind of risks because basically we don't believe in the institution, but we know how this system works. We need to yeah. use the institutions, but we don't put all the faith on that, you know? 80% is more organizing, 20% is more legal stuff by the institutions.
So I was thinking of it in a different way. I was actually wondering what your take is on building your own institution and specifically on the issue of membership dues. Like that's one thing that traditional labor organizations have is membership dues, which give them more resources to do more organizing and also provide a link of accountability between members and the organization. Do you have a take on that? Are you interested in pursuing a model that incorporates membership dues?
Basically, our model is more political consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
We know how important is the dues from the membership because when you have 600 or probably 1,000, you multiply for $10 a month, that's a lot of resources you can start bring to the organization. But it's more like, okay, you know, because we believe we need to develop a leader. You know, you are responsible just basically for your organization. Mm-hmm. And you have that commitment, like the necessities and how much materials we need. And, you know, at least now we have an office, we have to pay the rent. You are part of your organization, you have the commitment. You know, nobody has to go behind you like, okay, you had to pay. Mm-hmm. So always we remind, but we don't obligate basically the membership to pay dues. It's more a political consciousness.
Okay, great. Is there a question back there?
Thanks. Just going back to enforcement, could you talk more about your interactions with the state or the city on enforcement? Clearly, wage theft and not paying the minimum wage is illegal, regardless of organization. So I'm just curious what your experience has been with trying to get the laws enforced.
For who? Well, just that's minimum wage is a law in the New York City. But it's not a crime if somebody steals your wages. It's like if I, right now I'm very hungry and I go to the store and I stole one apple, the owner called the police and basically the police came and they're going to arrest me right away. But the owner, they stole thousands or probably millions of dollars in wages. Even if the court decided the owner is guilty, he don't go to the jail. The only thing he has to pay. Mm-hmm. So that's why when we say what is law, okay, we have different kind of laws, but some kinds of laws are not as strong for the people which basically violate those laws. I don't know if that answers your question. I can answer more in the legal aspect, but in the organizing aspect, I think it's my point of view.
Any other
So yeah, this is for Mahoma and Juan, and anyone else wants to pitch in, I guess. You know, as organizers who are on the ground and doing this work, and you're, you know, confronting things like wage theft and discrimination every day, and you know that although we have really progressive laws in New York State and New York City especially, they're insufficient, especially for domestic workers, day laborers, and other marginalized communities. You know, how could the law students and lawyers in this room, you know, be advocates for the work that you're doing? You know, what could they do to support the organizing efforts that you guys are doing on the ground every day?
In terms, can you ask in a little bit different, in terms of what can the law school students do to support against wage theft?
Against support the work that you're doing organizing, how can they be advocates in, you know, in the legal profession for the work that you're doing organizing?
I mean, I think something that he had mentioned, I guess doing internships at these different organizations and going out with organizers to actually see firsthand what's actually taking place and thinking of ways to prevent and fight it in the future, I guess. Because as currently as it is, you know, it's as he's mentioned, you know, there's laws, but if workers themselves don't start enforcing it and like know their rights that they gotta be paid $9 an hour currently in New York City, then it's like they don't know enough to bring it to our attention and think it's fair. So I think educating workers about their rights and everything, that would be really beneficial. But also just understanding, having like on the ground what's actually just happening throughout these industries, because they operate different, right? If you're organizing hotel workers, car wash workers, laundry workers, they all work differently and operate differently, and laws would they'll have loopholes in, I guess, in different industries. So I think that would be helpful, having folks actually understand on the ground what it really means.
But also you can offer your skills or your knowledge about laws. Just basically we can make workshops just to teach the membership how exactly the law works and the new different laws, because sometimes we spend too much time organizing. We lost the track about the new laws, and sometimes, you know, it's the law changed, now it's different, or now they have a different law for U visas, for wage theft, all these kind of things, which basically we really need more deep, like we're organizers, we are not lawyers, we don't know how to explain exactly the language, the legal aspect, you know? So on that way, we need a lot of support just basically to help us to understand, not only me, but also all the workers, which basically, you know, we don't have those skills because we don't study for that. But you can explain us in normal words what's mean all these kind of laws. It's really important because, you know, part of the, you share this knowledge is like share. Yeah, you share the knowledge is like, if you are a worker or you are working the car wash or are a construction worker, you don't have $2,000 or $3,000 for a workshop in one of these universities just to learn basic laws, which basically you already have those knowledge you can share with the workers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I wanted to ask another question. You know, Julie had to leave, but she said something I thought that was like really beautiful about how like people are not just workers, but they also have identities. They're like, they have like gender and race and all kinds of different qualities that make them a whole human, and at different points in their lives, different things are important to them. And the other thing that she described was kind of like a great interchange between traditional labor and alternative labor organizations, where alternative labor organizations go out and organize people along some of those lines, like Black Lives Matter and the ICE raids, and then those people can be fed into like the trade unions, and both strengthen each other. And I think that's a great ideal scenario. And I'm wondering if you guys have experiences of tensions, of times when a union has been maybe less, has been less willing to collaborate, and like what were the reasons around that? Or good stories, or like great, or stories. I know that you guys also have great examples of collaborating with unions in your work. But I'm just wondering how that negotiation comes about, like what's the range of reactions that you get from unions depending on who you're organizing?
I think in our terms, I really can't speak for our WDSU in terms of that, but the experience that we've had with the union has been really great in terms of us sitting down at the table and the three organizations coming together and figuring out what's the best for the campaign, but also what it means for the workers and their best interests at the end of the day. I think in point case, it was that case I spoke about in Vegas where it was 8 workers, and typically you wouldn't see unions focusing on such a small shop and investing so much resources for 5 months, having organizers there, pulling resources politically, having folks from all over the city come to support it. So I think that's an example of like good collaboration, and where labor traditionally wouldn't even target these workers, they put a ton of resources in, and that means organization. But it was to what you mentioned, right? It's like the organizations come together and like understanding what's best and bringing out like a broader picture for the campaign also.
And why was Make the Road like best suited to, like better suited than the unions to reach out to car wash workers? Was it because like the size of the workers was so small at these workplaces?
I think for that part was that since Make the Road is ingrained in the communities like Bushwick, yeah. Queens, a lot of these car wash workers were already members or reaching out to Make the Road for different aspects, legal, housing, because that's what becomes key in a campaign. If I'm speaking with a worker and he's like, you know, they're trying to evict me from my house, then I could call Elizabeth, hey, Elizabeth, like, this is happening, and then that trust and that bond begins, and that's where I start, like, talking to them, agitating them, and that's how it starts, and it's great to have those resources at hand that traditionally we didn't have. So I think Make the Road was key in having access to these workers than the union going out there and targeting.
And we have a question over here. I'll also do a quick plug after that for Make the Road. If you want to be part of this great organizing model and like do direct services and litigation and policy work, you should apply for an internship at Make the Road New York. Also.
Hi, my name is Aaron Hlegg. We're from NYU Law School. I'll also make a plug for Make the Road. I worked a lot on nail salon cases, and obviously that's become sort of, a lot has happened in the last year with nail salons, and I think there's a lot of parallels with what has gone on with car washes, and I had two questions. One is mostly for Mahoma and maybe for Juan. One is there's an argument that nail salon owners are making that ethnic Asian owners are being targeted as the nail salon campaign, and that's not fair. And I'm wondering, I don't know as much about the car wash industry and the ownership of it, and I'm curious about what the sort of demographics of owners of the car washes are. The second is nail salon owners seem to be saying, it's not fair because there's wage theft everywhere. Why are you picking on us? I'm not saying I agree or disagree, but I'm curious from your perspective what you think about that and how you would respond to that.
That kind of argument we heard in all industries, not only the, every single owner of deli, pizzeria, car wash, nail salon, or even like B&H, which is a huge warehouse, they're gonna say that. As an owner, you are training to be an owner, that's the first thing you had to learn to say, we don't have an answer, just basically is like what we face when we are fighting against the capitalism, which is is what it is. You know, the owner always, they're going to say that. It's like everything is unfair for them when they had to pay or they had to increase the salaries or they had to pay tickets because they don't respect the law, whatever. It's similar happened to us when the police department gave us a ticket for transit or something like that. You know, it's but, you know, that's what we're facing every day.
I think we have time for one more question.
Hi, I'm Jeannie Meyer. Malma referred to me, but as their lawyer. But one of the things that I wanted to just say is that from the perspective of the way we've organized with Laundry Worker Center, our policy has really been to make sure that the workers understand it's their struggle, and we as the attorneys have their backs. It's not our struggle. We can participate in it. We can go to the picket lines. We can be the support. We can, you know, provide knowledge. But in essence, this is an important struggle for their empowerment and leadership. And I think that's really one of the things that's probably the biggest thing that's led to the success of the struggles is that people, the workers do see themselves having a long-term commitment to organizing and being empowered. And so I just think that's an important fact to mention. And in terms of MoMA didn't tell you that actually the case that where they were sued for RICO, they just had to fold. We finally beat them back, and I'm not allowed to say the amount of money that they won, but because it's confidential. But it was a really tremendous victory, and some of the workers from that campaign are now organizing more places. So that's one of the things that I just wanted to give a shout out to the LWC for that.
But if you want to know the amount, you have to go Google 360 law and put Liberato campaign, and it's going to come out, the amount and everything. Yeah.
Great. So thank you to all the panelists. Thank you so much for all the work that you're doing and for sharing it with us. And thank you to the NYU Review of Social Change also for putting this whole thing together.
Jeannie reminded me with the talk of the settlement that I think we have a lot of board agents and DOL people here today. So if you're trying to get your call returned, this is the time. Also, we're being recorded, so don't say anything that you don't want to end up on the record. And thank you guys so much. We're going to take like a 10-minute break. Let's try to get back in our seats by like 11:50. If you signed up for CLE credit and you forgot to sign in with your time, and also after the panel, if you can sign out with your time for just for the panel two, you're welcome to stay, of course, for panel three, just so we can get you that CLE credit, which will be via email. All right, great. Thank you, guys.